Good morning, Keyspire. I'm going to ask that everybody please come on into the room and take your seats. My name is Amanda. I'm a real estate investor. I'm a business owner, the senior manager of coaching and content at Keyspire, and the privilege of being your in-person host for today's event. I would also like to recognize, of course, Jazz and Simeon and their entire team at REC. Not only have they made the arrangements to have us at this absolutely beautiful venue this morning, but they've taken care of the breakfast for us this morning. They've obviously got the most amazing show planned for you throughout the event. So once again, just a huge shout out. You guys are absolutely a pleasure to work with, as always, and put so much work into preparing this event for all of you. We are actually live streaming this event across the entire country to all of our fellow Keyspire members and even into the United States as well. So a big hello to all of you who are joining us within the Keyspire Inner Circle group at home. So welcome everybody. The show is about to begin.
REC Experience presents Real Estate Entrepreneurship Leadership with your host, Jazz Takkar. The REC Experience Podcast is now on air.
Keyspire Mastery Meetup, Episode 1.
Hey, hey, hey. Thanks for being in the REC Experience. I'm your host, Jazz Takkar, and I'm so excited. We're coming to you live from the Donalda Golf Course here in Toronto, Canada, in front of a live audience. So super, super stoked about this episode. It's part one of a two-part series today. And joining me is my business partner, Simeon Papayelias. How are you doing?
I'm okay, my man. Hello to everybody online and live.
He still thinks that the jury's out on who's better looking, but I don't know who he is.
Yeah, it's me.
What a guy in the middle here.
Yeah. We'll do a little poll at the end, maybe. A little exit poll.
A live poll on. So, in the middle, took the drive in from Hamilton. A lot of us know his voice and obviously know his face from Miller Thompson, Mr. Kyle Hampson. Thank you. You're actually a returning guest, my man. You've been on this podcast.
Yeah, I have. Last time I was in the studio itself, and I was happy to know that there was an edit availability, and this time we don't have that, so we gotta be on your game.
Let's make sure. Watch what you say, Kyle. Yeah, exactly. Watch what you say.
Don't worry, something recorded.
Okay, good. We're fine.
So today, I wanna speak about RTO, LTO. We hear a lot of different terms, rent to own, lease to own. Very, very practical and common strategy in the investment world, but somewhat misunderstood sometimes. There's just a lot of people don't know exactly what it is and how it works. How does an investor get involved? What's the role of the tenant? So I really want to spend all of our time on this episode really clearing up and making sure we get some clarity around LTO, RTO. So Simeon, I'm going to start with you, buddy. What is a rent-to-own?
An LTO is a lease-to-own or a rent-to-own is simply an investor buying a property that is matched with a tenant who is a buyer. A tenant who has an option to purchase the property that you have bought. Now, that is the essence of what it is.
Now, why would a tenant need that though? Why wouldn't the tenant just go buy the property on their own?
Right. So the very essence of the strategy, and it's very important to understand as an investor.
I love when Simeon takes off the glasses because it's real serious. I love it.
I'm trying to structure this from one to kind of go down. So the very essence of it is that you are going to be helping another fellow human being get into housing. Just like being a tenant, you can be a grease ball.
Yeah.
Landlord,
yeah.
Or you can be
slumlord, is the term,
or you can be a housing provider.
Yeah,
you can have a business that systematically helps people live their lives well.
Yeah,
and your profit is your reward for doing so, but not because you're going to get as many doors as possible, have cockroaches running through the hallways. Yeah. Who cares about the tenant?
Yeah,
the LTO strategy. The very fundamental of it is you are going to help a young family. So who is it for? Why is the tenant need you? Is a lot of people make a lot of money, but at the end of the day, they may not be able to save all that money because they have two kids. They're paying for Montessori and they're paying for hockey and they're paying for everything else that they're paying. So coming up with a down payment in an area like Southern Ontario, where the average ticket now is 700K plus, a million plus in Toronto, et cetera, is an easy task. So there's a long list of people who want to be homeowners, and they will be homeowners soon.
And I like to say some of them, because it does come from the perspective that they don't have enough from a down payment, like they don't have enough of a down payment. Sometimes there's just some, like there's mistakes on their credit. I call them mistakes on their credit, right? Where they just need some time. If they had 3 years, 4 years, 5 years, they can repair their credit.
Well, life happens. Not everybody who has bad credit is a delinquent.
Exactly.
So they went through life. Life happens. There was separations. Mm-hmm. There was a time where you got canned at work beyond, for reasons beyond your control. There's a trillion ways that life happens.
Right.
Now, but this is where you are. You have bruised credit. That's the fact. How you got there is irrelevant. Bruised credit.
Now the investor comes in and essentially acts as the lender. So yeah, they're going to be purchasing the home for the tenant, and then I love the lease to own strategy because you have a predetermined exit strategy. So let's talk a little bit about the exit strategy from an investor's perspective. So they're going to be purchasing a property for the tenant, and it's already predetermined when the tenant's going to be buying it back from them.
So there is two major components to the transaction. I think this is where the appropriate lawyer, an investment-focused lawyer, is going to help you. Because it doesn't matter where you're from, you're gonna, when you're assembling your team, these are the professionals you need. And Kyle, for example, which we in this room we know very well, but online, if you're watching from Regina, you don't have access to Kyle, but you have access to Miller Thompson.
Yep.
So you can access professionals that are knowledgeable. So the structure itself requires an APS. So Kyle, the investor, is going to meet with us. We're going to look for a deal. We're going to find a property. We have a tenant lined up. We're going to make an offer on the property, like a normal offer purchasing a property. And you are buying the said property.
Mm-hmm.
One transaction.
Yep.
The second component. So you've closed it. It's done. You're going to enter into a lease. In Ontario, we're regulated by the government. You have to use the formal Ontario
lease agreement. Yep.
The lease agreement. And this lease agreement now is going to have strings attached. It's going to have contract. It's going to have an option to purchase the property. It's going to have an agreement attached to it that while you are the tenant at this property, you have an option to give me a deposit against the future purchase. You're also going to be making payments of X amount of dollars per month that are going to be credited to you at closing, like a forced savings plan.
I love it.
So they don't have to come up with 5% today. They can come up with 3% today. So whatever they're going to be required to close on, so if they're fixing their credit, they're going to need that 3 to 5 year period. If they're going to need to save more money and their credit's just fine, you're going to have an increased monthly payment that forces them to save that money. So when it comes time that the term is up, the investor is going to give them a credit for those funds and use it against the purchase price. Meanwhile, you have the highest cash flow you could ever dream of.
Yeah, the tough part that I've seen over the decade that we've been doing rent to owns is that they're not readily available because the tenant to find one qualified tenant, you generally need to go through like 50 applicants, 50, 60 applicants, because not everyone has the security deposit to readily available, right? With that said, when they come up, it's something that I think most investors should definitely look at this strategy because of the cash flow, because of the predetermined exit strategy. Kyle, from a lawyer's perspective, you've seen a lot of different contracts and a lot of ways that people are doing it. What's probably the most common way that you're seeing contracts written out when it comes to a rent-to-own?
So there's two most common ways. There's one which I don't like, and we talked about this offline.
Yeah, let's talk
bring
about
it
that
up
one.
Here.
So yeah, let's talk about that.
You'll see
yeah, bring
there's
that up.
Yeah, yeah, there's some companies out there, and this is generally when the person who's going to be the tenant is the actual owner of the property right now, and they're in some sort of dire financial straits. They have bruised credit, as Simeon put it, and so they want to sell the property to an investor. and then sign a separate agreement of purchase and sale to buy it back 3-4 years later at an increased price. And you have all these extra terms in the schedules to the agreement of purchase and sales. The reason I don't like that is that you're going to be hampered when it comes to financing 4 years down the road, when that prior owner, now tenant, future buyer mm-hmm. needs to go to their bank and get financing to purchase the property back from you once they've fixed up that credit.
And you said trouble with financing. Is that because lenders you're finding just don't like the fact that it's written out that way?
Lenders do not like an agreement of purchase and sale from 4 years ago.
Yeah, they don't understand.
They're going to make you write it again so that it's contemporaneous. So to me, there's no point in doing that to begin with, because now you've got to get the old tenant who may not be able to purchase the property to write up a new agreement. And it just causes a whole lot of problems.
And if the dynamics in the relationship have changed.
Oh, absolutely. A lot can happen in 4 years.
And as a result of them not being able to close, how would they be cooperative? Why would they be cooperative?
Exactly.
It's going to make it very tough.
Yeah. So the better way to do it is exactly how Simeon phrased it, right? You buy the property, whether you're buying it from the old owner or you're buying it from, you know, just a regular person reselling and you're going to get into a lease with a new owner. It's better to have that second transaction as a lease with an option. Okay.
Yep.
And the reason that you want to have that is twofold. Again, from the financing side, for the tenant buyer who's going to be purchasing the property, it's better for them. You have all the terms in that option to purchase, the purchase price, the closing date, the amount that you're collecting on the deposits, defaults, which is the biggest thing.
Yeah.
Because if you're an investor who owns that property and that tenant buyer defaults on it, you're going to want to get out of that, because now you can sell it to anyone. You've opened up that market of the people that you want to sell it to. You can put cross defaults in between the lease. If they default on the lease, you've got to take them to the landlord tenant board mm-hmm. for damage
and,
or something.
And this is the structure.
Exactly.
So continue, but this is the benefit you get. Like, a realtor can take you so far. An experienced realtor can take you further. But if you have the right lawyer structuring the deal, that's where the money is made. That's where the mistakes don't happen.
Well, you spoke about it just off air, building out the all-star team, right?
You want to make sure you have the right people. You just said the cross claim. It's already built into the contract.
Yep.
You're not going to fight for it later.
There's 55,000 realtors in the greater Toronto area. Most of them won't even know what cross claim and like these terms. That's why you need to bring in the experts. Yeah. Let's talk about returns, the exciting stuff. That excites me anyways. Let's talk about what expected returns can be just from case studies that we've done recently, Simeon. So talk about, the last 60 days, what kind of returns have our investors being, what are they seeing when it comes to a rent to own?
So we've changed our structure a bit. We used to have lease to own always in our tool belt as investment focused realtors that we are, because that's what we are. We have made, I'll just hint to it. We've made a pretty exciting partnership in our last few deals are with a very experienced, actually the CEO of the company. It's HOS Financial. It's a homeowner soon. And Terry Heptich, who is the CEO of the company. He's actually the president of CAREP, which is the Canadian Association of Rent-to-Own Professionals. Yeah. So he's the biggest nationally. His structure, as far as I'm concerned, is second to none. I actually learned a lot from him after doing it for 10 plus years. But this is what he does. He's not a realtor.
Yep.
He's a deal maker and structurer. So the last quite a few deals that we have done, we've done in partnership in a joint venture effort with investors and with HOS. Like, we're calling it REC, rent-to-own, powered by HOS, because they're going to be the engine and the actual person executing the groundwork over the term.
And most importantly, qualifying the tenants.
Right.
Because
that's the biggest.
That's the toughest part, as I mentioned earlier, right? Because
but let's just say this room tomorrow morning says, "Okay, Jez, I want to do an LTO."
Yes.
Well, you're going to be waiting 3 years.
Yeah, you won't have enough tenants,
opportunities,
enough opportunities. So continue.
So the cash on cash is anywhere between, and again, it's fluctuating in different markets. So if you find one in Hamilton, typically both the return, cash on cash, the return overall, is going to be a bit higher. Why? Because rents have normalized and the purchase prices are still lower. So when you go into those, and I shouldn't say secondary markets because they're own alpha markets, but non-GTA, you're getting bond yields. Anybody can say whatever they want.
Yep.
It's the safest market in North America, period. Well,
it's a place to park your money, right? It's why the major REITs.
And grow equity.
And grow equity over the long period, right? But I want to focus on
the return.
The returns, because that's what people are always wanting. So,
I'll tell you,
right?
Cash on cash, you're looking average of 4 to 8%.
Yep.
We've never performed under 18%. I think it's been the lowest LTO annualized. So 18% per annum is the lowest LTO we've ever performed in. Highest being 40 plus, because it actually sold twice.
Right.
The first tenant couldn't do it. They got somebody else involved a month later. We charged a new price and the return skyrocketed.
That's what we were looking to do.
Typical is 25%.
We want the tenant to close.
Typical is 20, 25%.
And just to your point though, we want the tenant to close.
Of course.
Because going back to your first point, why rent to own? It's because you're providing housing for a family generally that can't afford it or has bruised credit, right? And so from that perspective, that investor got lucky because we had to do it twice and they saw returns as high as 40%.
Yeah, but they had to go through, you know, eat a couple of those dirty little sandwiches that I'm not going to say it on air.
Yeah.
But I mean, it wasn't easy for them.
Right.
So they had to deal with a default.
Yep.
It was the same tenant that was able to get back at it, but it cost them more.
Yep.
And there was headaches involved. But typically, headaches are tied to higher returns, BSMA.
Just like, and I'm going to kind of leave the mic for both of you guys to answer this. Just like any investment strategy, there's always benefits, but there's things that you need to consider as well. And so some people call it pros and cons, and there's tons of pros and benefits we just spoke about. I want to talk about things that you need to consider when you're doing a rent to own, because I don't want to sit here and paint a rosy picture without talking about sometimes some thorns. And so let's talk about that. What have you seen, Kyle?
So mainly the thing that I see is poor drafting on contracts will lead to uncertainty down the road, and either the tenant or the investor or both being disappointed with how the transaction worked. Okay, so that's one. Number two, sometimes I've seen investors leaving money on the table. You know, you're targeting a price in that option agreement for 3-4 years down the road. You think the market's going to appreciate X percent. It appreciates a lot more than X percent. And so you've left money on the table. You know, there you go back to that nice, you know, feel good point. You know, you're helping a family, you're helping, you know, someone get into the market.
Right.
As long as that's enough for you and you're happy with that X return, that's great.
Because sometimes it can be a big difference. If the predetermined price was, let's use 4.5% or 4% year over year increase for 4 years, but the market performed at 7 or 7.5%, you left a lot of money on the table. So that was a great point. What else?
So that can happen. And then, you know, the process of going through a default, right? Tenant defaults. So there's a lot of areas in which they can default in this type of strategy, right? They default on just their monthly rental payment. They damage the unit. They default on the time period in which they're able to exercise the option. They default on the additional payments that you're going to be receiving as credited towards the purchase price. So once you have that default, all of a sudden you're brought in again, right? It doesn't go in the nice streamlined process that you're supposed to go through on this. So you've got to get professionals back involved. If it's an accountant or a lawyer, that adds extra fees,
for sure.
Right? If you've got to bring your realty team involved again, because you probably have to relist and resell the property as well. So all of a sudden now your time's being sucked up again because of a default. So those are the big high level ones that I've seen a lot.
So you mean yourself?
Well, I think Kyle has covered the points. I definitely have some color to put on these things.
Yep.
So going back to the fundamental of what is an LTO, if we're talking about a straight investment, cut everything else out. This is a fixed term. This is as close as you're going to get to a money market investment.
Yep.
It's closed-ended.
Yep.
There's a beginning. There's a definitive end. There is structure within it that is paying you, just like if you invested in a second mortgage. There's an interest payment. If you don't get that interest payment, there's a default. Mm-hmm. So if you take it to try to simplify it as much as possible, the pros and cons of it are the same point. The pros is that there is a beginning and an end. Mm-hmm. The cons is that there's a beginning and an end.
Great point. I love how you articulated that.
If you were to ask me what is my favorite investment strategy, I think anybody who's ever spoken with us before It has nothing to do with exit.
Yep.
It only has to do with beginnings. I acquire real estate and I don't sell my real estate.
We hold on to it. That's how you create long-term wealth.
Forever.
Yep. Now, this is something nice, though, to add.
For better or worse.
Right.
For better. And this is kind of the point. So if the market takes a downturn, in a lease to own, you're protected. You agreed upon a price. If the market took a downturn, a slight downturn, and it's worth a little bit less of what the person bought it for, they're still obligated to pay you that price. If they don't want to buy an investment that is worth less than what's agreed upon, they can walk away. But they're walking away defaulting on their initial deposit and all the payments they made to get there. So it's very hard to lose in a lease to own scenario.
Yeah, because worst case scenario, you still own the property.
Right.
You could refinance.
So it would become a long-term hold.
Yeah.
So whoever's looking for something bad surrounding lease to own, I'm sorry, there's nothing there.
Yeah.
Really and truly. Because holding like a normal income property, you can have a shit tenant. Like,
yeah,
there's no other way to put it.
For sure. You're allowed to say that word.
And that creates problems. With a lease to own, you can run into some same type of scenarios.
Right.
So there is nothing that I can honestly tell you that is bad surrounding the strategy, other than the fact that you mentioned, where the market has significantly, especially the last decade, the wind has been in the sails of the landlord and of the investor, where they have fueled appreciation beyond our wildest dreams. We use 3 and 4% in appreciation. We've performed at 8, 10, 12, 14% in certain markets, and it's created a lot of millionaires.
Look, I think I'll go back to the fact that from an investor's perspective, you have to be patient when it comes to rent to own. That's the biggest downside for me, because it just takes a while to put a deal to first to find the tenant and then the tenant to actually find a home. So there is a lot of patience needed. Short-term patience, right? That's needed to actually put a transaction together, all while you could be missing other opportunities. So you just want to take that into consideration, figure out in your portfolio where a lease to own can go in terms of timing, because you made mention to a mortgage investment. It's the same thing. You could do a 2-year term.
Sure.
You want to see how you can place it, get the principal back, get the interest back, and possibly invest into another opportunity. I love to end these pod sessions with one tip each. And so I'm going to go around the table. I'm going to start with you, Kyle, because you're just closer to me. One tip for investors, and it could be around rent to own. It could be around just in any tip for an investor.
Anyone who's been to an investor summit has probably heard me harp on a few things. Three main things, right? Engage the right team, right? Whether it's realtors, whether it's mortgage brokers, whether it's insurance providers, accountants, lawyers, get people who know real estate, because I'll use lawyers, for example, we're like doctors. Everyone has their little specialty. Mm-hmm. You do not go to a doctor who's a ear, nose and throat guy when you have a problem with your foot.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah.
Any lawyer can't necessarily advise you on these types of things. It's the same thing with all those other professionals that I just talked to you about. Okay. Number two, when you are going for lending, full disclosure to the lender. If you are not telling them something critical, that is fraud. Okay.
Yeah.
And I've had a situation this year where someone defaulted because they couldn't get financing because a lender found out about something that they didn't tell them, and they got sued for $50,000. Okay.
Wow.
Nobody wants to deal with that. And the same thing is, you know, don't rush into a deal that you're not comfortable with or you're not familiar with. I've seen a lot of people do that.
Yeah.
I've seen a lot of people do that. They didn't get the right advice, right? Or they're like, oh, I got to jump on this because of this opportunity. You're better in the long run for patience, right? Do your due diligence on it. Consult the right people. Make sure you're making a good, sound decision, because you do stand to lose quite a bit.
Thank you.
Yeah.
I love how much value you brought. I asked you for one tip. You gave us three. So thank you, buddy. I appreciate that.
I felt like I was not talking a lot.
You're caught up now. So
yeah.
You're caught up now.
I have reached my quota.
I actually
we're good.
I loved how you said I didn't talk much, and then you look over at Simeon.
It's all right. Go ahead.
Simeon, your tip, brother.
Talk longer.
I'm going to stick to the exact same thing earlier. We have an audience of over 500 people, 200 in this room, and the hundreds online. I'm going to just reinforce, use your time wisely, grow your network. Please understand that we have been at this for almost 15 years together and on our own before then. So we have a lot of experience and we have a very different comfort level than some people in this room may. So do your due diligence, network carefully and grow your teams. Grow your teams.
Me, I get the last word. I love that. After doing now coming up to 80 episodes of the podcast, I would somewhat be an idiot if I didn't pick up on some patterns. And I've sat with the likes of Michael Saraceni, Scott McGilvery, a couple of the Key Spire coaches as well, investors. We had one episode with Sue Murphy, who went from zero to 11 properties in 2 years. An episode with three inspiring ladies who did about 5-6 properties and investments within like a year and a half. And I never met their husbands. And so they did it all by themselves. And the pattern that I picked up on is taking a leap of faith, especially in real estate, because you can take action and just hold on to the property and do due diligence within that time period. So, for example, you can do a rent to own and it's conditional. You can make it conditional on anything, really, whatever the seller agrees on. But if you make it conditional on financing or home inspection, you tie up the property and then do the due diligence. Because where I've found a lot of investors make mistakes is sit and think about it, and but then the opportunity goes by them. In real estate, hold up the property, tie it up, and then do the due diligence. Just make sure it's in the contract, and we leave that to Kyle. He'll figure all that stuff out. With that said, gentlemen, thank you. I know you need to run. Thank you so much, Kyle, for joining us. Simeon, you're going to be joining me for the second episode a little later on. But thank you, and I really, really appreciate your time.
You bet.
Yep. Happy to do it.
This has been the REC Experience Podcast with Jazz Takkar, an REC Canada production.
Hey guys, thanks so much for watching and listening. Please, please take a second right now to subscribe and follow us on whatever podcast platform you're watching or listening. It means the world to me. Thank you.